Hey guys, so it's been a while since we did anything on this YouTube channel, but today we decided that we'd try something a little bit different.
We just got back from an epic 2-month trip through Ecuador and Peru, and we had a lot of questions about where we went, the practicalities of it all, like what it cost, how we got around and stuff, so we thought we'd answer those here.
Yeah, there's a blog post down below as well, so go ahead and check that out, and we go into more detail in that about the places we saw and everything, but in this one we're just basically going to show you the highlights and tell you a little bit about the logistics of the trip and stuff like that.
Yeah, so first of all, I guess, how did we do it? How did we plan it? Where did we stay and all that sort of stuff? For this trip, we tried something different. We did mostly Airbnbs, so unless we couldn't find one or something, then we would get like a hostel or guest house, but for, I'd say, 98% of the time, it was Airbnb, which we loved. We loved having our own space, and we got to stay in some really unique places.
Yeah, we've always been about like boutique hotels and stuff like that, so to have an Airbnb is kind of like it's your own boutique hotel just for you. Very few people get to see it because there's not, you know, 20, 30 rooms in it. Mm-hmm. There's just one or two rooms. Yeah. So we felt like it was like a really special trip in that way, that it was all basically really unique kind of places. And we'll talk about them a little bit more throughout the video as well.
Yeah, and also we got to stay, like locals own them. So we were supporting the local people as well, putting money directly into their pockets. So we thought that was a bonus.
Yeah, definitely.
So that was the accommodation.
Yeah, a lot of people were also asking how we got around Ecuador and Peru, and it was actually pretty easy. Like the buses are easy to book. You can just go into the bus station and book your bus ticket.
Yeah.
And yeah, the only thing that we found that was annoying is that the buses wouldn't go into like major cities. A lot of the time they would stop on the highway and drop us off.
Yeah.
So then we had to flag down like a pickup truck that was there for the sole purpose of bringing people in. But every single city, it seemed like we got dropped off on the highway. We're like, hello, what do we do now?
Pickup truck or a taxi or whatever. But we were never, ever directly in the town. Like, I don't think ever.
I don't think so. And so we had to use our Spanish a little bit to figure out the next steps. Yeah. But it was actually really simple. And the buses were relatively comfortable. So that was all right.
Yeah, it averaged out for the buses at like roughly $1 an hour US.
Yeah.
That was on average. Some were less, some were more. After doing Ecuador, we did think that next time we would rent a car because the bus drivers were crazy. Like, so actually we've done a lot of traveling and they were pretty crazy. They sped, they like took the corners really fast.
Yeah.
It just felt kind of sketchy. But they were comfortable enough.
And the roads were good in Ecuador. That's another reason why we could have, you know, rented our own car, but that's all in hindsight.
Yep.
And Peru was the same thing, basically $1 an hour or so for the buses, and the transport was pretty easy. We did take a couple flights on the trip because we had to fly to the Galapagos Islands, and we had to fly from Ecuador to Peru. We didn't have to, but we didn't want to do like 35-hour bus rides. We're a little bit over that. So, but those flights weren't too expensive. The one from Ecuador to Peru was expensive, actually. It was like $500 a person to go from, I think it was Quito to Cusco. But
I don't know why that was so expensive. It must have been a weird time that we booked, but our return flights to Galapagos were $400 each.
And then also we did internal flights in Peru because we flew from Cusco to Lima, and that flight was really cheap. I think it was like $50 or something like that.
That was a
great
flight.
So some of the internal flights were a lot cheaper, but for some reason that one that took us from Ecuador to Peru was expensive.
So transport was good. The accommodation was great. And then the other question we get all the time too is, first of all, food. Food could be expensive or cheap depending on where you ate. For us, we would look for the almuerzos, which are like the set lunch or menu del día. So you get a soup, a main, and a juice. That's usually what you get. And it was around $3 or $2.50. And it was huge. Like sometimes we would share one.
Yeah, they were massive. And sometimes you can find them for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. So sometimes a breakfast set meal, including like eggs and a juice and coffee or whatever, will be like $1.50.
Mm-hmm.
And the lunch one is like $2.50 to $3, like you said. And they can get them for dinner for the same price as well. So food can be really, really cheap.
Mm-hmm.
But also it can be expensive, like Doris said, if you go out for dinner at night and you have a Western meal like a pasta or something like that. It's going to be similar to prices at home. It's still cheaper, actually.
We were thinking it was around 10 to 15 US.
Usually.
For either a Western meal or if you were having like a seafood meal on the beach or
That would be probably 20.
Or like a upscale Ecuadorian, like in a fancier restaurant.
Yeah. Same with Peru. I think the prices, we're kind of listing them both together because a lot of the prices are similar.
Mm-hmm.
The only difference on this trip with the cost would be Galapagos, and everything was about 40% more, maybe 30% more for the meals and stuff like that. But all the other prices are pretty standard across the board.
Another question is safety.
Yeah,
how did we feel? That was like a huge question because there is a lot of crime and things that happen in South America. Before this trip, we've been to Colombia, Argentina, Chile, and Uruguay, and we never had any issues. And the same thing for this trip.
Yeah. That obviously doesn't mean like it's a safe place to go just because in our experience we didn't have an issue. We were definitely careful with our stuff, our belongings. We weren't like flashing our cameras around in our phone. We were conscious of it. But we did carry them around. Yeah. And we took photos when we were in even the old town in Quito where everyone said that there's a lot of pickpockets. So I think you have to kind of be careful. And you got to know where to go. I know that in Lima, Peru, we stayed in a really nice neighborhood called Miraflores, and we visited Barranco. But if you go to other areas in Lima, they can be super dangerous. So when you're booking your accommodation and stuff, you kind of got to be careful. Just kind of Google around what the best, safest areas to be are, and just kind of be mindful of it. But really, we felt safe the entire time, and we were out at night, we were out in the mornings. It felt fine.
Yeah, you just have to ask the locals as well, like where to go, where not to go. But yeah, we had our iPhones with us the whole time. You're just mindful, I guess, is what it is. Yeah. And with anything, you know, you're not going to walk home in the middle of the night in the dark down alleys. You're going to take the Uber, by the way. There's Uber there. So you can take Uber around or just take a taxi, whatever, just so you get to your accommodation safely.
Yeah, definitely. There was Uber in Guayaquil in Ecuador, in Quito in Ecuador, and in Cusco and in Lima, right? Those are the four that we had of all the places we visited.
And that was great. Utilize that.
Okay, so next on, we're going to go to talk about the highlights of the trip.
Yes.
Like I said, the article down below has basically every single place we went and how we felt about the places. And there will be a lot more stuff coming out on the blog later on.
Yeah.
But for now, we'll talk about our top five kind of highlights from this trip. So
should we start with Ecuador?
Yeah, let's start with Ecuador.
Okay, so the first highlight of Ecuador would be this little jungle, I guess, rainforest town of Mindo. People usually do a day trip there from Quito, but we decided we were going to spend four nights, and we ended up absolutely loving it.
Yeah, we did.
It was the most nature-filled place. Stunning.
It was stunning. It was only like an hour and a half by bus from Quito, which was where we landed to start the trip. So then we went to Mindo first, and it was easy to get to, like just one bus in, and we stayed in this beautiful Airbnb that was like a three-story treehouse kind of in the middle of the cloud forest.
Yeah.
And this is like a UNESCO-listed bioreserve. It's one of the most natural, pristine natures there is in South America.
Yeah, it was awesome.
And it was just beautiful. There's so many birds.
600 types of birds, species of birds in Mindo. There's like rafting, there's canopy, zip line things that you go across in like a bucket. So it's a cable that goes across the canopy of the jungle, and you're sitting in this little metal bucket thing, and you go across it.
We took one, and Doris just completely froze. It was hilarious. She couldn't move because she's scared of heights.
Waterfalls.
We spent our days like either hiking and doing all that stuff, and in the mornings we would sit on our like balcony on the third floor of this treehouse, just drinking coffee and looking out, watching the birds eat fruit and fly around. It was unbelievable, like super, super quiet and peaceful.
Yeah.
And we loved it.
Excellent nature.
Next up, my next highlight in Ecuador would be Otavalo.
Yeah.
Again, it's just an hour and a half from Quito, so we had to go from Mindo back to Quito, then
a bit
another
longer, wasn't
2
it?
Hours maybe?
Yeah, like 2
Yeah. But it's easy to get to by bus from Quito, and the town itself was kind of nondescript.
Yeah.
Like, it wasn't a beautiful colonial city. There wasn't a lot going on. There's a couple nice plazas and a nice church. But what we really loved about Otavalo was the surrounding areas.
Yeah, definitely. They're surrounded by volcanoes, lakes, waterfalls, and mountains. So we did a lot of hiking and just, like, honestly enjoying the view. It was so stunning.
And this is another example of a place that the place we stayed, the Airbnb, really made it go to that next level, because we stayed in this beautiful kind of farmhouse.
Yeah.
And the neighbor was the owner or the manager of the property.
Yeah.
And they were Ecuadorian, so we got to practice our Spanish with them.
Mm-hmm.
And it was just this beautiful place. It had windows, like floor-to-ceiling windows on two sides, and it looked over the lakes and the volcanoes.
Yeah.
So that was just stunning. That really made it.
It was a huge highlight. There's also a weekly market there, which, again, that's why people just day trip to Otavalo, because they have a really great Saturday market.
Yeah.
But we recommend staying longer, and that was definitely a highlight for us.
Yeah, and stay out of town if you can.
Yes.
There is a hostel close to where we were. That I think is a lot cheaper than the Airbnb we stayed in. So if you're on a budget, you could stay out of town, which I recommend, but still, like, you can stay in a hostel and see all the stuff around the city.
Yeah, because it's a bit hectic in town, so it was nice to have the peace and quiet staying out.
Yeah, definitely. What's your next highlight?
Oh. Okay, probably let's go to Galapagos.
Oh, we got one more before Galapagos.
Ooh, Quilotoa Loop.
If you want to do Galapagos, yeah, we have to do both. So Quilotoa.
There's so
many
highlights. Honestly,
we wrote a bunch of highlights on this piece of paper.
So
we're going to try to slice them down to five.
So the Quilotoa Loop is in the central highlands of Ecuador. It's not even a loop. It's just kind of this route you can take from town to town, like village to village. and it's hiking, so you carry all of your own stuff, but you get to sleep in hostels along the way, so you don't have to carry a tent, which is great. And you eat at the hostels. So we just had like our warm gear and whatever we needed for actually hiking. And we did 3 nights on that.
Yeah.
It was incredible. The views along the way were epic. We didn't have a guide or anything. We just had like a paper map. We had a GPS, and nobody really hires a guide. It's normal to do it that way.
Yeah, it was kind of, we found quite a bit of information about this loop online, but still when we went there, we didn't know what we were going to do. We didn't know the route because people call it the Kealotoa loop, but no one really finishes the whole loop, like Therese said, so we were confused. So we're going to have some information on the blog about that, how to do it the way we did it. And it was just beautiful. It was one of the highlights of the trip for sure.
Again, another peaceful situation. You're just out in nature. There's hardly anybody around, just passing little villages and you know, livestock and stuff. It was great. Recommended.
Now we can go to Galapagos, I think.
Okay, go to Galapagos.
Yeah, I think Galapagos was probably, if we had to pick one highlight of the whole trip, arguably Galapagos was that highlight. It was just so amazing. It was a bucket list for us to go to Galapagos Islands. We'd always thought about this, and it did not disappoint. From the moment we landed, we were just blown away.
So it's one of those places where we're always like, oh, it's going to be really expensive. You have to do like a $1,000 a night cruise and blah, blah, blah. But we decided to do it independently, which is how we prefer to travel anyways. And we're going to stay on the islands, so land-based. So we spent 5 nights on Santa Cruz and 5 nights in San Cristobal. And we just did day trips around those islands.
Yeah. And it was the way to do it. I think it was a great way to do it. If you're on a budget, it's your only option because the cruises are so expensive. So on both islands, we just, like Therese said, rented a hostel or whatever. And it was easy because there are taxis and people to drive you around to show you other parts of the island. So you base yourself in one of the main towns and then you can just hire a taxi and they know the tour. Basically, they just say, which tour do you want? They have a piece of paper. And I think it was like $40 for the day. Depending on what island you're on.
It depended which tour as well.
And which tour.
From $40 to $70.
Yeah, from $40 to $70, depending on how long you were in the taxi. But we did a few hours. I think we spent $40. And he took us around basically everything we wanted to see in the island. So it made it really easy to have a day together.
And he was just a driver.
And like, he was just a
driver. You don't have a guide, so you're just a driver and you get to go kind of do your own thing.
Yeah.
Obviously, the huge highlights were the animals. The wildlife was spectacular, and there was sea lions everywhere on San Cristobal Island, literally just on the park benches, walking along the seawall kind of thing. Like, they were just everywhere. I think one of the coolest things was we rented snorkel gear for $5 each, and we just went for, like, a hike, and we found a beach, and we went in the water, and within 2 seconds, literally put my face in the water, there was the biggest turtle I've ever swum with right there, and we probably saw about 6.
Yeah, we did,
A marine iguana, so swimming iguanas, and huge schools of fish, like massive, massive fish.
And on that same day, we left that beach and went to another beach that's like right close to town, like where everyone stays, there's a beach right there, it's white sand, beautiful. We hopped in there as well with our snorkel gear, and 2 sea lions came right up to us and started playing around. And before we went to the Galapagos, I was saying to Doris, like, oh, I hope we get to see a sea lion. They're everywhere. Like, if you go to Galapagos and don't end up tripping over a sea lion, then you've been in the wrong part of the Galapagos.
Especially, so San Cristobal.
San Cristobal, if you go to San Cristobal, because they are everywhere on that island. It was so cool.
And then Nick obviously did some scuba diving as well, two really epic spots, and they were full day trips. So it's more expensive to scuba dive, but you actually get, it's a full day kind of tour.
Yeah.
So you do 2 dives, and then you go to a different island by boat, and you have a naturalist guide who explains the island and shows you around.
Yeah, that was a real highlight as well. So, and also we had a full meal. Like, they gave us a lunch. So when I go on dive boats, usually they might have snacks on the boat, some water. No, these dive boats in Galapagos, they have an entire lunch. And like Doris said, there's a naturalist on board, tells you all about the animals. And yeah, it was worth it. I think the dives were, I don't know, 150.
It ended up being $200 and $220, depending on which island.
So $200 on San Cristobal.
I think so.
And I think $220 on Santa Cruz.
I think so.
And San Cristobal and Santa Cruz both have these main dives that I recommend you do. On San Cristobal Island, it's Kicker Rock, right?
I'm like, will he remember?
And that's an amazing like seamount out in the sea, and it's often circled by hammerhead sharks, tons of sharks. But the one that I liked the most was actually on Santa Cruz, and it was Gordon Rock. And that was amazing because the visibility was better on that dive. So at one point, we just kind of, all the divers in our group just clung onto the coral on the side of the rock, like in the
volcanic rock.
It's another sea mountain in the middle of the sea. And the shelves go down so far, you know, on each side, and to a depth of, I don't know, 100 meters or more. And then we just clung onto the rocks, and the sea kind of cleared up, and out of the blue was like 20 hammerhead sharks. There were manta rays, eagle rays, Galapagos sharks, reef sharks, turtles, all like in one field of view.
That mola, what's it called?
Oh, and then we swam out further, and there's a mola mola, which is this really weird fish that kind of looks like this, and it swam by, and it was about 15 feet high, maybe 10 feet high. It was enormous.
It's crazy.
Very, very cool to see that fish. Yeah.
I think Galapagos was amazing. The beaches, everything. I was just gonna say, if you do it by land, like how we did, like land based, obviously there are these islands in the middle of nowhere, so you do have to be conscious of how you are spending your time, what you're buying, what kind of garbage you're creating, everything. Like, we always had our reusable bottles, and we would fill them up from the main, you know, jugs everywhere, and not buying plastic bottles. Obviously, no straws, nothing.
Take out with whatever you bring in, take it out.
If you can, like, try your best to do that for sure. Yeah. And then we were obviously trying to eat where the local, like, fishermen were having their food as well. Like, they'd bring in, the local families, the little Morazzo places.
Yeah, and fishermen.
yeah. And then staying, again, locals, Airbnb, like, that kind of thing. We were really trying to support that and just be responsible tourists. And then, again, like, no touching the animals, staying more than 2 meters away. That's a big thing as well.
Yeah.
It's just important stuff.
Yeah, definitely. Mm-hmm. Okay, that's probably the end of Galapagos. That was a long Galapagos part, but we loved Galapagos so much.
Yeah.
So let's move on to the next part.
So from Ecuador, we went over to Peru, and we knew we were going to do the Inca Trail and Cusco and Sacred Valley, but we weren't sure what else we would do. So we ended up doing those three places and Lima. And again, we really enjoyed Peru. We had great experiences with the people. The first thing we did notice, though, straight away was it was more touristy than Ecuador, like by far.
Yeah.
It could have been because we were in, you know, Cusco and these touristy spots, but it was definitely more popular, and there was English spoken a lot more frequently, and there was, you know, people selling stuff everywhere.
Yeah.
But we still had really great experiences.
And we felt safe in Peru just the same as we did in Ecuador, so that was amazing. And Cusco is really safe. You can walk around Cusco pretty much at night, and you can feel safe. There's tons of people around, even at 11 o'clock at night. So that was really nice to be able to feel safe and enjoy the city. And the highlight that was another one that would probably rival Galapagos would be, of course, the Inca Trail.
Inca Trail.
And that leads to Machu Picchu, one of the seven wonders of the world.
Yeah, so there are a few ways you can get there. You can just go by train now is a new thing. You don't actually have to do the pilgrimage, the trek up. You can do a two-day hike. You can do all these various routes for 10 days to get there, but we chose the classic Inca Trail, and it was 4 days. Well, it was 5 days for us. Usually it's 4 days.
Yeah, yeah.
And we really recommend that.
It was incredible. We couldn't believe it. We always trek. When we go on treks, we always have, like, a big backpack on. We're carrying all of our water a lot of the time. We're carrying all of our food, cooking supplies, because there's nothing on the way. Like, the O-Trek in Patagonia, Chile, we did that. We had to carry everything ourselves. This trek had 20 porters for our group of 12 trekkers. 20 of them. So there was someone carrying all of our stuff. All we had to carry was our own water and, like, maybe a rain jacket if we needed it. Mm-hmm. And the porters were so cool. They're so strong, too. They carry so much stuff. They carried up all the cooking gear. We had a chef, a sous chef.
All, like, the tents,
guides,
everything.
Two guides.
They carried our personal belongings as well, like whatever we needed, to our clothes and stuff. So we had two guides, 20 porters, and there was 12 hikers, including the two of us, which was actually a big group. They said there's usually just six.
Yeah, we had a big group.
But it was a great group of people. We all got on, so that was fine. Something that surprised us was we thought, you know, it would just be like a nice hike the whole way, and then we would arrive at Machu Picchu and be like, oh my God, the ruins. But there was stunning ruins the entire way. Like, each day we saw probably two sets of ancient Inca ruins that were in incredible condition.
Yeah. Yeah, the Inca Trail is literally, there's just scatterings of Inca ruins all around the Sacred Valley, all around Cusco, and all along the Inca Trail. So I do recommend, if you do have time to do the hike, do it. I mean, it's really nice to just take the train up and see Machu Picchu if you've only got a day or two.
Yeah, or if you're not physically fit enough to do it,
if you don't feel like you can do it. It was tough. It wasn't easy,
It was one of our easier ones, though, we said.
Yeah, compared to the O-Trek that we did in Chile and compared to the Quilatoa Loop even, really.
Nepal and everything. Yeah, but I think it's because we didn't have to carry anything.
Yeah, yeah. So, and we're used to carrying it. We've done a lot of these treks, so it felt a little easier to us. Yeah. But it was just stunning and definitely highly recommended. It was a highlight of this entire trip and one of the highlights in all of our travels. So.
Yeah, and we chose to go with Explorandes, the company. That's the other issue, too. People are always like, who do you go with? Because there's tons of companies. So we did a lot of research, and we ended up going with them, and they're the ones who pioneered the first tour, actually.
Yeah.
It was 1975.
They were the first company to ever take tourists up officially on the Inca Trail.
So they know what they're doing, and we cannot recommend them enough.
Yeah.
Like, professional, responsible, like, It was great.
The food was excellent. We had three excellent mm-hmm. meals every day. And we would wake up in the morning. Sometimes we had to get up at like 4 or 5 in the morning early. But they would come by, like, Nick, Doris, and they would put a bin of hot water with cloths to wash up with and give us hot cocoa every morning mm-hmm. or coffee or whatever we wanted.
Would you like tea, coffee, or hot chocolate? I was like, oh, hot chocolate, please.
Yeah, it was service. It was really, really good service, and the meals were incredible.
And our guide was super knowledgeable. Yeah. It was just, like, the perfect trip. We have no complaints about it, which is pretty cool, hey?
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. We had a good group, everything. So, definitely do your research before doing mm-hmm. an Inca Trail, because there are literally hundreds of companies.
Yeah.
And if you want to take our recommendation, we're not sponsored by them or anything, but Explore Andes is a great company.
Really good. Something else that you have to know is before you do go on this trip is you should acclimate in Cusco beforehand, because you are at altitude. So Cusco's at 3,800 meters, is that right? So a lot of people are coming from sea level, obviously, so then you don't want to just go there and boom, go on some trek. We actually spent 5 nights in Cusco.
Yeah, we did.
And we had people with us who only spent 1 day, I think it was, and they were feeling it. Like, they weren't feeling great the first couple days, so acclimate.
Yeah, one girl came from Miami to directly to Cusco, and she was vomiting on the first day. You get better, of course, but, like, it's not that high that you're going
to
have
Just don't expect real to trek issues. The next day.
Yeah, give yourself some time.
Yeah.
So that's basically the highlights. And yes, like I said, check out the article down below. We're also going to have a bunch more content about our trip, why we chose the companies we went with, what our trip was like, all the places we visited in each country.
Things to do there.
Things to do in every city that we went to. So definitely stay tuned to the blog and stay tuned to this YouTube channel if you're watching it here, because we're going to have more information, more videos here as well.
Yeah, and don't miss Ecuador and Peru. Those are amazing countries in South America.
Highlights.
Thanks for watching, guys.
Bye, guys.
Bye.